Very good morning to all of you. So this is regarding the experimental design and optimization. So I will brief. First, let me tell you what is the motivation behind this talk. In our daily life, we have to, like many a times, we have to do optimization. Some of the techniques we are already familiar, as you can see here. So I have classified these optimization techniques into three categories: mathematical techniques, stochastic techniques, and statistical methods. Some of these you are familiar with, like probably every one of you has done linear programming. You all have done. Maybe some of you have done network methods, game theory, dynamic programming also some of you have done. So these are, we classify them as the mathematical techniques. Then we have the stochastic techniques. Basically, what we call as the stochastic techniques is where the parameters are highly uncertain. So since all of you are from the engineering background, so I can take one or two examples. We all have done workshops. Like we do on a lathe, we do turning. Now we all know that suppose I increase the cutting speed. Suppose I increase the cutting speed, the material removal rate will increase. So the parameter is quantifiable as well as its effect on the output parameter is also fairly certain. We don't know how much, but definitely it will have a positive effect. Now compare this. This is like one of the instances. Now compare this. Suppose I change the coolant in a turning operation. Suppose I change the coolant. What will be the effect of change in coolant, if at all? If at all. Or what will be the, suppose I increase the temperature of my workpiece, or I, like nowadays so many people, they are doing cryogenic treatment of the tools. So suppose I do the cryogenic treatment of the tool, what will be the effect of these changes on the material removal rate? That is highly uncertain. Wherever such situations are there, the techniques we apply, they are classified under the category stochastic techniques. Like decision theory, statistical decision theory, queuing theory, so simulation methods. We'll not be covering about them. This is just an introduction. Our main emphasis would be on the third category, which are the statistical methods. Again, in this, though we have so many techniques, statistical regression analysis, cluster analysis, pattern recognition, I will be concentrating on the design of experiments. When we talk of optimization, or maybe in general we say process optimization, some of the examples I have listed, obviously, it is far from being exhaustive. So we have engineering applications of optimization. You can see that it will have a wide range of applications across so many disciplines. Like you will see design of aircraft and aerospace structures for minimum weight. Now, this is an entirely different thing where we are trying to weight ratio and all those things we are trying to, strength to weight ratio we are trying to calculate. Then we have, you see the second one, finding the optimum trajectories for space vehicles. So not only this, we will have applications in civil engineering, in the design of frames, foundations, everywhere we have the applications of optimization. Fourth one, which I just mentioned, selection of machining conditions. There's a cutting process. Not only that, we have optimum design of electrical networks. Allocation of resources or services among several activities to maximize the benefit. Controlling the waiting and idle times, queuing in production lines. Design of pumps, turbines, heat transfer. And then compare it with another optimization application, shortest route to be taken by a salesman visiting different cities. Design of material handling equipment like conveyor trucks, cranes, and the design of optimum pipeline networks for process industries. So many different applications are there. Essentially, let us first try to define what is process optimization. Obviously, what we are trying to find out here is the maximum or minimum value of a response. It could be anything. We select the response. Selection of the response is entirely within the domain of the person who is doing it, or the experimenter, which we can call it. Then once he has finalized on the response, what is the minimum or maximum value of a response? And then he tries to find the conditions, whatever may be my process, or whatever may be my application, whatever may be my experiment. So we try to find out the conditions which will give me the whatever I have decided, whether the maximum or the minimum value of a response. Then we have, what do we do next? To determine the controllable factors that will affect the desired response. So I think today is the fourth day, so some of the things may have already been covered, isn't it? What do we call as, okay, let me say, we have basically two factors, controllable and uncontrollable factors. So you see here, uncontrollable we also call as noise factors. So you see, even within the noise, we have different classifications. We have outer noise, we have inner noise, and between product noise. Controllable factor is all clear, isn't it? Controllable factors, all the dimensions, material selection, process design parameters, all these are controllable factors. Uncontrollable, okay, let us take one or two examples. In outer noise, we say seasons, okay, humidity, temperature you spoke of, volt, batch to batch variation, machinery aging. So that comes under the inner noise. Obviously, like if I take the same example which you are saying, machining of any machining. So when you start the machining, till the end of the machining, there will be some tool wear, isn't it? Which is unavoidable. So of the condition of the tool at the end of the cut will be definitely somewhat different from the condition which was at the start of the machining. So that comes under the inner noise. And then we have something like between product noise, which is a piece to piece variation. So you are taking up one piece, then you take up another piece, the variation. Not only that, if we talk of process, the process to process variation. Isn't it? Like I was using a CNC machine, and I started a cut from a particular place. When I come back to the same place, again there is some inaccuracy. It is not exactly the same place which was in the previous operation. So all these comes under the noise factors. So I come back to the third point. Obviously, these uncontrollable or noise factors, there is no way we can eliminate them. So what we have to do is we have to minimize the effect of those uncontrollable factors. Then next, to determine the optimum combination of controllable factors that will give the best value of the desired response. So what is the combination? Different possibilities are there. You have selected a parameter. You can do it at different levels. We have different levels of the cutting speed. Depending on the availability in the machine, you can set it at different levels. Feed, depth of cut, you can all set it at different levels. What is the combination? Because my output response will be one, usually. We do have multi-response optimization, but right now we are not focusing on that. At present, our emphasis is on single response optimization. So we have different levels. Which combination will give me the best value of my response? Suppose not only material removal rate, maybe I want a very good surface finish. Now this will come in conflict with the material removal rate. If I increase the material removal rate, my surface finish will deteriorate. So that way I have to decide what I want. That is what was the meaning of that. We want to find out the optimum combination of controllable factors that will give the best value of the desired response. Then we have multi-response optimization, where a balance is to be achieved between a number of desired responses. Probably that will also be covered separately in your course. Two of the most commonly used techniques of process optimization are Taguchi experimental design and response surface methodology. So my emphasis would be on the Taguchi experimental design. What is the strategy of experimentation? What I can do is, it could be anything. Even in electrical engineering, you may be conducting some experiment. Okay, you have different parameters, different levels you are setting. One obvious strategy is best guess experiment. There are certain things you know by intuition, isn't it? So you can guess that if I change it, I take these values, this will be my response. Approximately, you are able to guess. So this is used a lot more successful than you might expect, but there are disadvantages. One is the role of the uncontrollable factors in such cases. You are no way able to control the effect of those noise factors. One factor at a time approach. Again, you can use it. You have different parameters. Each parameter is called a factor. So you have different levels. You keep all other parameters fixed. For one parameter, you change the different levels and study. Biggest problem with this type of approach is it is very time consuming, very expensive, isn't it? Just to give you an example, just to create your interest, I think how many of you, we are talking of this Taguchi technique. So we must know. So this technique is very easy as we step by step see it. So you can apply, this is simple, even using Excel software, you can create your own sheet. You can go and go through this method and you know exactly at every step what is happening. Why is it happening? So all those things are easier when you take it that way. So we have one factor at a time approach, and then we have statistically designed experiments. So even this Taguchi technique, there are other statistically designed experiments also. They are all based on the Fisher's factorial concept. Just to give you an example of this one factor at a time, suppose I have four parameters, यही आप ले सकते हैं, कुछ भी आपका है, डेप्थ ऑफ कट वगैरह वगैरह एनीथिंग, एंड वी हैव थ्री लेवल्स ऑफ ईच, फोर फैक्टर्स एंड थ्री लेवल्स ऑफ ईच. इफ आई फॉलो दिस वन फैक्टर एट ए टाइम अप्रोच, हाउ मेनी टोटल एक्सपेरिमेंट्स आई नीड टू कंडक्ट? 3^4, 81. टेकिंग एवरी कॉम्बिनेशन, एवरी पॉसिबल कॉम्बिनेशन वन फैक्टर एट ए टाइम, I need to conduct 81 experiments. By using the Taguchi technique, you can get the same result by only 9 experiments. Only 9 experiments. Same result, everything you can interpret, you can get your effect of each factor at each level. All these things you can know by, and it is a scientific method. So it is acceptable everywhere. Suppose you send a publication, it is acceptable, well acceptable. So this is the detail of the what I mentioned here as the statistically designed experiments. So we have full factorial design, total number of experiments required to run all possible combinations of all the levels for each of the factors. Then we have fractional factorial design. This is basically what we are going to concentrate on. Fractional factorial design, a portion of total combination. If orthogonality is maintained, the fractional factorial matrices would be called as orthogonal array. So this we will study in detail. What are orthogonal arrays? How to arrange one orthogonal array according to my experiment, how to conduct an experiment according to this orthogonal array. So this we will study in detail. The Taguchi experimental design, which I mentioned, is also known as the robust experimental design. What do we mean by robust design? The fundamental principle of robust design is to improve the quality of a product by minimizing the effect of the causes of variation without eliminating the causes. This is achieved by optimizing the product and process design to make the performance minimally sensitive to the various causes of variation. This is known as parameter design. So obviously, as I mentioned, if you take all the experiments, so a lot of time and energy will be used. Robust design methodology serves as an amplifier. That is, it enables an engineer to generate required information needed for decision making with much less experimental effort. Instead of 200 experiments, you need to get only 27 or something experiments you need to conduct. So what do we need to do? In this, there are two important tasks to be performed in robust design. Establish a leading indicator of quality, which will evaluate the effect of changing a particular process parameter on the performance of the product. Obtain reliable information about the process parameters with minimum time and resources. This is achieved by employing signal to noise ratio. So what we do is, we conduct the experiment, we take the raw data. That raw data is not directly analyzed. From the raw data, we calculate signal to noise ratios. And what we do is, we maximize the signal to noise ratio. So when we maximize the signal to noise ratio, that means the effect of noise is getting reduced. And we use orthogonal arrays. This, in any case, I'll come. The application of robust design are not limited to engineering field. The technique has been successfully employed for profit planning in business and cash flow optimization. Robust design methodology offers simultaneously improvement of product quality, performance, cost and engine. In a normal experimental design, what we do is the noise factors, they are either kept constant or techniques like blocking and randomization are employed to minimize the effect of noise factors. Whereas on the other hand, what we do in robust design is to find the levels of control factors that minimize the sensitivity of the product function to the noise factors. And in experimental design, normal experimental design, it is more useful for continuous factors. Whereas orthogonal arrays can be used for continuous as well as discrete factors. If I have to go from 2 to 4, 4 to 6, that is a discrete. If I can go from 2 to 2.01, 2.02 like that continuous knob, like we have that regulator, one is a continuous one, another is a discrete one. So that is there. In statistical experimental design, the presence of interactions. So that is very, very important. We will see it, how these things are. Interaction is when I am changing two factors simultaneously. The interactions among control factors, they are taken care by two techniques, linear graph and interaction tables. So that facility is also available in Taguchi design. So we use them so that the interaction is minimized. Interaction between the various factors is minimized. Now let us see. Now this we are going to cover in detail, all this slide. So let us go through them, have an overall idea. Basically, background we have covered, any experiment you are about to conduct for your research purpose, for your other, like even in industries, it is very widely used. Taguchi design is very widely used in the industries. So what we have to do is decide the important input process parameters and their levels. You are an experimenter, you are a researcher, you are a project engineer, whatever you could be. What are the various process parameters? And what are the levels I need to take? So this you can do by either pilot experimentation. You can conduct some pilot experimentation. Or you can also do your literature survey. By literature survey also, it is possible that if I have this parameter, what is the likely role of these input parameters? So you get some idea. You can also conduct the pilot experimentation. So you decide what are the important process parameters and their levels. Response parameter, whatever is the response parameter, material removal rate, and its characteristic. By characteristic, we mean what are we seeking? Highest value of that or the lowest value of that? Okay. If it is profit, you are seeking the highest value. If it is the cost is involved, you are seeking the minimum value. So you can do anything. Then based on this, so this you have to finalize first. Suppose I select an input process parameter and it turns out that it is not important. Or by mistake, if I leave out an important parameter. There is facility. What you can do is, you can select the maximum number of process parameters possible. If one or two of them are not important, this method will tell you that. Okay, this method will tell you that. Then what you can do is, then you can modify your experiment. Once you come to, you can eliminate them, then you can conduct your experiment again. Particularly when research is involved, you profits are involved. So you are willing to put in that kind of effort, isn't it? then once you have done that, select the appropriate orthogonal array and assign the parameters to its various columns. Okay, I think what I will do is I will take up an orthogonal array and first explain it to you what it is, and then you will be able to appreciate this better. These are two examples of orthogonal arrays. Let us concentrate on, say, this. It says L9, the example which I gave also, 3^4 orthogonal array. Now, what you notice in this? There are some rows, there are some columns, and some numbers are written. This number 111222, this refers to the level of that factor. It refers to the level of that factor. Obviously, as you can see, this orthogonal array you can use for maximum of four factors. Okay. And three levels each. Four factors, three levels each. Then what about each row? Each row tells you the values of those factors at which you will conduct your experiment is to be conducted. So you have a total of 9 experiments in this case to be conducted. Okay. One important thing, you can leave out one or two columns, but you cannot leave out any row. Okay. So if you have three factors of three levels, still you can use this array. So by leaving one of the columns blank, but row you cannot leave. Any two columns, if you take, the combinations occur equal number of times. All the combinations occur and they occur equal number of times. Like suppose you take up 3 and 4. You see 1 occurs once, 2 occurs once, 3 occurs once. 2-3 occurs once, 3-1, 1-2, 3-2, 1-3, 2-1. Possible 9 combinations and all are occurring once. And you can take any, like say 2-3 you take. Again, you will see that all these combinations are occurring once only. They are occurring and once, but their position is different. Position is column to column, that position will change. I will give you another one, which is in fact the most commonly used array. There are a number of arrays available, obviously, like we have discussed. The number of factors you will finalize, isn't it? The experimental will finalize. The number of levels for each factor also you will finalize. Okay. That is irrespective of, that is not, nothing to do with Taguchi. That is to do with what you are trying to seek, what you are trying to do, isn't it? So you decide that. Then based on that, you have some certain number of factors, you have a level for each one. You select an orthogonal array. So there are total 18 standard orthogonal arrays. L9 is one of them. There are total 18 orthogonal arrays, standard. But different, you can manipulate or you can modify those orthogonal arrays also. So that way, any number of factors of any number of levels, it is possible to find an orthogonal array or customize an orthogonal array. Theek hai. Make example leta hun, which is like if you are doing research at PhD level or like that, or you are looking for some industrial application, minimum L18 you go. Obviously, larger the array, better is the precision. Simple, largest. So minimum L18 is acceptable. So I'll just focus on that. Thoda mere paas baad mein hai. I had added it subsequently. This is an L18 orthogonal array. Okay. Again, you see that there are 8 columns. Okay. And then there are 18 rows. Okay. 18 rows. Now suppose you take, say, let us at random take 6 and 7 column. six and seven column, you just see one one combination. One one occurs twice, two times, first row and 12th row. 12th row. Then 2 2, let us see, second and 10th. Okay, 3 3, third. Clear ho gaya na? Or 1 2 2 1 1 3 3 1 2 3 3 2, all these combinations, they occur twice and they occur equal. This is the meaning of orthogonality of an array. Now that we are on to it, let me explain one more thing. Why this is very widely used. You see, column 1 has 1 1 1 1 1 1 and 2 2 2 2. L18 is an example of a mixed array. Means we have one factor at two levels and all other factors at three levels. So you can use a combination. Like for example, say, agar hum thoda aur example le, like you are conducting research on welding. Polarity of welding, that can be only positive or negative. So you will select an orthogonal at this L18. So polarity you will assign to column number 1. And then all other factors you will, like current is there, voltage is there, you will assign to remaining. Okay. Then we have, ek adhi cheez aur bata deta hu. We have interaction tables also. Separately I will tell you. So it tells you that the interaction of, suppose, this is again an example. Suppose I take up my interaction table, it says that interaction of 1 and 2 is visible in third column. Suppose. So what you can do is, if you leave out column third, your interaction is taken care of. So you can leave out any of these columns. That will not affect the orthogonality of the array. But you need to conduct 18 experiments. So the important thing is, a column can be skipped, but a row cannot be skipped. So we were at point number 2. Select the appropriate orthogonal array and assign the parameters to its various columns. For each row, you will conduct the experiment. Study factor effects and find out the optimum combination of input parameters. Calculate the best value of the response characteristics. Now this is very important and very, like, you can say, the beauty of this method. Again, taking that example, we have four factors at three levels each. How much are the total combinations? 81. Total 81 combinations are there. Okay. Each combination will give you certain value of, suppose you are calculating the material removal rate. Each combination will give you certain value of material removal rate. You have tried only 9. When you use this Taguchi method, you have tried only 9. It could be very much possible that the optimum combination exists outside this array. Isn't it? It could be very much possible. This method is able to tell you that combination, which is even outside its array. Okay, not only that, it will tell you mathematically, you can calculate it, you need not conduct the experiment, that if this combination is used, this would be the material removal rate. This is the highest value of material removal rate. Okay, that is the beauty of this method. Next, calculate the range within which the experimental value should lie and conduct confirmation experiment if required to verify the same. Now, we have come to know the optimum combination. There are obviously two possibilities. Either it is part of the array or it is not part of the array. If it is part of the array, you need not conduct any more experiments. If it is not part of the array, you take that combination and conduct your experiment once again, only for that combination. and it will tell you that how much should be the difference between your experimental value and calculated value. That also it is able to do. Okay. And lastly, perform analysis of variance to find out the significance of the various factors and their relative contribution. Like I told you, you may have selected 10 parameters. One or two out of these may not be significant, may not be important. So by this ANOVA, it tells you that these parameters are not significant. And not only that, significance of the and their relative contribution out of those important ones, which is more important and which is less important. So it is able to tell you that also. So now we will take up this technique in detail. First, some definitions. Designed experiments are called matrix experiments, and individual experiment constituting one row of the orthogonal array is called run or treatment. In fact, it may be interesting to know that this method was from where these terms have come. This method was first evolved to maximize the agricultural yield of a field. Settings are referred to as levels and parameters as factors. The response variable obviously is called a dependent variable because it is dependent on the values of my input process parameters. Factors are called independent variables because you can set them. Factors are also commonly known as treatments. This I mentioned, a term which comes from agriculture, where design of experiments was first developed and used. Another important term which we will be subsequently using is the degrees of freedom. What do we mean by degrees of freedom? Of course, in different contexts, we have different meaning. Like robotics, we have different meaning. In context of a machine, we have different meaning. Here in Taguchi, that is very, very simple. A three-level factor will have degree of freedom 2. A four-level factor will have degree of freedom 3. What is the background of this? It is, suppose you have like three levels, 2 ampere, 4 ampere, 6 ampere for current. 2 ampere, 4 ampere, 6 ampere. One of these will be default values. You will either start with 2, 4 or 6, whatever it may be. Suppose you start with 6. 6 can go to 2, 6 can go to 4. So what is the degree of freedom? 2. So that is the simple meaning of degrees of freedom. Columns of the array are mutually orthogonal. This I mentioned. What do I mean by this? It means that, just for repetition, for any pair of columns, all combinations of factor levels occur and they occur an equal number of times. This is called the balancing property and it implies orthogonality. This is also the balancing property of the array. The number of rows of an orthogonal array represent the number of experiments. The number of columns represent the maximum number of factors that can be studied using that array. Taguchi has tabulated 18 basic orthogonal arrays that are called standard orthogonal arrays. Two examples I have already shown you, L9 and L18. So those are two of the standard orthogonal arrays. Depending upon the number of factors and their levels, it is generally possible to select one of these for a specific requirement. The standard orthogonal arrays can also be modified to suit complicated designs. So another one you see here, L8, so which can accommodate a maximum of 7 factors at 2 levels each. So if you have, say, number of factors, just a indicative guide, number of factors 2 to 3, you can use L4. 4 to 7 for a 2 level L8, 8 to 11 you can use L12, 12 to 15 you can use L16. For 3 level, 2 to 4 number of actors we can use L9, 5 to 7 we can use L27. 5 levels, number of actors 6, L25, number of actors 11, L50. And then there are mixed arrays also. So three mixed arrays are part of the 18 standard orthogonal arrays. They are L18, L36, and L54. Okay. So you see, you get a general idea that you can select any number of actors, you select any number of levels based on the standard arrays or by customizing. The first two techniques which I mentioned, dummy level and column merging, they are perfectly fine. They don't affect your experiment anyway adversely. So you can easily go in for those techniques. This way, with these arrays and then with those facilities available, techniques available, you can design your own array for whatever is your requirement. This I have already explained. Let us take up a case study to further see all that we have discussed, how we actually use it to achieve whatever we have desired. This is a typical case study of a machining operation. All participants with mechanical engineering background must be familiar with this. This is an electrical discharge machining process, EDM process. Not necessarily, if you are not aware of the process, not required. Just we will see how we proceed. This could be with any process that you intend to use. Now, in this, these are all the possible process parameters. I have tried to keep it very simple. These are all the possible process parameters. We have discharge current, sparking voltage, type of flushing, type of dielectric, pulse on time, pulse off time, and polarity. So these can be possible when you are carrying out your machining using this process. Now, with all these seven parameters, as we have already discussed, you can narrow down on certain parameters depending on what is your requirement. So you need to finalize two things here. One is input process parameters and their levels, and the response parameter and its characteristic. Like, for example, here I have two responses. One is micro hardness I am talking of, another one is surface roughness. So after carrying out the machining, it is similar to a material removal process. People who are not from the mechanical background, it is simple material removal process. You have a tool, then you have a workpiece. With the help of electrical discharges, you are removing the material from the workpiece. So whatever desired shape you want, you can achieve with this. Now, after the machining process is over, the surface is available which we have machined. So one response I have taken, micro hardness of that surface, and another I have taken as surface roughness. So in general, your requirement may be different. In general, I have tried to take it in this way. Micro hardness is higher the better. That means I am seeking the maximum value of micro hardness. Surface roughness, lower the better. That means I am seeking the lowest value of surface roughness. Then out of these available seven parameters, depending on, as I told you, my pilot experimentation or my literature survey, I have seen that these three parameters, one is discharge current, pulse on time, and pulse off time, I expect them to be most important for my operation. I can take more if I have doubt. Suppose I feel that maybe polarity is important, suppose. So I can take up polarity as one of the parameters. if it is not important, subsequently I will come to know that it was not important. Right now, to keep things very simple, I have taken these three: discharge current, pulse on time, and pulse off time. Further, I have taken three levels of each parameter. So for current, I have taken 2 ampere, 4 ampere, 6 ampere. Pulse on time, some value, whatever is available on the machine, 5, 10, 20. And pulse off time, 38, 57, 85. So this could be anything within the range. You have a range, whatever machine you are using, you have a range which is available. Like in this case, maybe the machine I am using, I can get from 2 ampere to 20 ampere. But I want to conduct experiment on low values of current. So I have taken it on this side. That I have to decide. The researcher has to decide. Okay. So I have taken three factors and three levels of each. So obviously, as we discussed, based on these inputs, L9 orthogonal array was selected for the experimentation. So we can have up to four factors at three levels. So I have selected L9. The fourth column of the array was left blank. The orthogonality of an array is not lost if one or more columns are not used. Each row of the orthogonal array represents the set of values. This we have already discussed. So we need to conduct 9 experiments, L9. So we will at each combination, like you see here, now this L9 orthogonal array I have taken up and I have assigned the values. So discharge current in column 1, pulse on time in column 2, pulse off time in column 3. And 1, 2, 3, whatever was written there, I have accordingly filled in the values of the levels. So that means, suppose I want to conduct sixth experiment. So I will take the value of current at 4 ampere, pulse on time at 20 microsecond, and pulse off time at 38 microsecond. Now these 9 combinations are the ones out of total 27, isn't it? If I have 3 factors and 3 levels, total possible combinations are 27. So I am taking only 9 of them. So I may have missed some of them. I would have missed definitely some of them. So what I do after I conduct this experiment, machining operation I conduct, then I get some values. Surfaces are there. I measure the micro hardness and I also measure the surface roughness on those. So those values are now available with me. Like this. So I have mentioned here, like 1, 2, 3, all 9 experiments. Micro hardness. So three values, like I have a surface, 3 values I have taken of micro hardness on the same surface. Then 3 values of surface roughness I have taken. Like that, I have completed this table. So first task is to calculate the SN ratio, signal to noise ratio. The formula for signal to noise ratio is this. For larger the better, we have this, where now this yi refers to each value of the raw data. So basically what I have to do is, suppose I take up the first one, 1 upon square of that value, whatever raw data it came, plus 1 upon second value square, plus 1 upon say third value, and 1 upon n 3. And then I have taken log, multiplied it by minus 10. So this is the formula which is used to get the signal to noise ratio. If you compare the first one with the second one, only a small difference. Now the raw data is available as the numerator. So if you look a bit carefully, so the purpose is to get the maximum value of SN ratio. So this is a way to minimize the noise factor. So signal to noise ratio I'm using the SN data. So this I calculate. Now these values I have put here. You see this SN ratio. So I have calculated for the micro hardness and I have also calculated for the surface roughness. Okay. So for each row, I have calculated, and then I have calculated the mean value. This mean value is very important. We will use it subsequently. Now, my very first task, once I have done this, my very first task, I have three factors and three levels. My first task is now to segregate all those, though I have used them together, all those levels and factors, and I have used different combinations. But for the detailed study, I need to separate them out, each factor separately and each level separately. So what is suppose now with this experiment, I should be able to suppose somebody asked me, what is the effect of changing the discharge current from 4 to 6 ampere on micro hardness? A researcher would be required to answer this. I can get that data from here. How do I get it? Let us calculate the factor effects. Calculating the factor effects is very simple. I go to the array. From there, I will explain. Let us have this L9. Now, the effect of first factor at level one, I will estimate by averaging the SN ratio of row number 1, 2, and 3. Let me repeat. First factor level one, I want to find out. I will take the SN ratios of 1, 2, and 3 and take the average value. Suppose I want to estimate the effect of factor 3 at level 2. Factor 3 at level 2, which values I will take? Second row, fourth row, and ninth row. Got it? Average them out. Depending on my levels, like if I have an L18, it would be different. Here it is like this. Okay. So this way I can calculate the factor effect of each factor at each level. Okay. Like factor 2 at level 3, factor 2 at level 3, what I will do? I will take the third row, sixth, and ninth row. Okay, so this I have mentioned here, very easy. So you can easily make a formula. Suppose here it is, you can do it even on a calculator, but suppose you are using L18, L27. So easily on an Excel sheet, you can have all these formulas and you can have your graphs accordingly. Even this work has all been done on Excel sheet. So I use this formula to calculate the SN ratios. Then you see here, this has been explained how to calculate factor effect of factor A at level 2, factor B at level 1. This I've already explained. Accordingly, I have generated this table. Now, this table is indicating me the raw data as well as the SN data. For further clarity, let me plot it. So you see, I have segregated out all the three factors, and it gives me the details of all the three levels. Suppose, let me take up the middle graph just for explanation purpose. What information do I get from here? Row hardness is maximum at 5 microsecond value. Okay. When I move from 5 to 10, there is a sharp decrease in micro hardness. When I move from 10 to 20, there is a decrease, but the decrease is not significant. So you can technically explain it depending on your understanding of the EDM process, why this is happening. That interpretation is to be given by you only. Okay. But the behavior is available from these graphs. Okay. Like first one, again, similar thing. When you move from 2 ampere to 4 ampere, there is a sharp increase in micro hardness. You can attribute it to obviously when the current is increasing, there is more melting, more solidification, so hardness increases. But the same explanation doesn't hold good for the next level. When I'm going from 4 to 6, there is an increase, but very minimum, very insignificant increase. Why this is happening, you have to explain. Okay, but it is not important in this context. Right now. Okay. So it is not important. So what I have got here is, now if I analyze them, all three of them together, what I get? Third level of peak current, first level of pulse on time, and third level of pulse off time gives me the best value of microhertz. So 313. Is it clear? 313. This combination may have been existing in the orthogonal array, or this combination may not have been existing in the orthogonal array. But I have found out the optimum combination by just conducting 9 experiments. Compare this with the graphs of the surface roughness. What do you get? See, in the previous one, I am using two symbols. One is for the SN data, other one is for the raw data. So what difference you notice? Raw data is by that dashed line. So minimum value of surface roughness is desirable. At the minimum value of surface roughness, SN ratio is highest. So the effect of what we are doing is the effect of noise factors we are minimizing. We are subsiding the effect of noise factor. So similarly, I get a combination for the best value of my surface roughness, minimum value of my surface roughness. Now, how do I calculate the value? Suppose it is, the combination is available in the orthogonal array. I have carried out my experiment on that combination. I know the experimental value. It is available with me. Suppose it is not available, then how do I calculate? You see, I calculate first the optimum value of my signal to noise ratio. Here, this eta, I am representing the signal to noise ratio. Optimum, how do I calculate? M. M was the mean of SN ratios. My possible combinations were A3, B1, C3. If you remember, for micro hardness, A3, B1, C3. So I have taken the average value at A3 minus M, B1 minus M, C3 minus M. So basically, formula is there, but you can otherwise also logically also think that where the deviation from the mean is maximum, I'm trying to maximize my value. So MA3 minus M gives me the maximum value of deviation of level factor 1 from the mean value at level 3. Then similarly, B1 factor B at level 1, whatever is the value, they will all be positive, because MA3, MB1, MC3 will always be greater than M, because when you are seeking the highest value. Got it? So using this, I get the corresponding value of my optimum value of SN ratio. This is just, next which you see is just a reverse of the previous formula. The previous formula which I had given here, this formula. If you compare the SN ratio formula for larger the better with this, you will see it is just the reverse of that. Okay, so I have taken 10 raised to power the optimum value divided by 10 minus value. Then reciprocal, I have taken the reciprocal and then I take the square root. Mathematically, just the opposite. optimum value of lower the better type of response characteristic. So I take it and I get, you see, I have obtained a micro hardness value of 682. This is in Vickers hardness. Now let me compare with the values here. So I was getting different values. If you see here, micro hardness 617595, different values at different combinations I have obtained. The best value which is possible with these factors and these combinations is 682 micro hardness, Vickers hardness. Is it clear? So I have, what I have obtained is, I have obtained the optimum combination of parameters and the actual value of response characteristics at that combination, irrespective of whether that combination is available in the orthogonal array or not. Yes, now your question.
Is it possible to draw the interaction plot?
It is possible. Interaction plot you can definitely draw. Like, for example, I'll tell you. I told you that in L18, the interaction of columns 1 and 2 is shown in 3. Okay. If you leave the third column blank, still you can, even if you have left this column blank, you can calculate the factor effects for this level, for this column. You can calculate using the same formula, you can calculate. Those factor effects will give you an idea about the interaction effects between factor assigned to column 1 and the factor assigned to column 2. Now we come to the confirmation experiment. Now suppose the combination of factor levels is not available in the orthogonal array. So we will conduct the confirmation experiment. I will get some experimental value. Right now I have the calculated value. Calculated value 682 is there. I will conduct the experiment. I may get, say, 671, 690, something I will get. Now, whether it is acceptable or not, within which range it should lie, okay, that is given by this formula, the confidence interval. I will explain it a bit. So we have, we'll calculate this various things. You see F alpha, that is the tabulated value of F ratio at 1, error degree of freedom. In addition to this, we will also see the value of factor effect. So this we do from the, we can get the tabulated value. So this is the simple statistical table. You can just have it, hai na? Because at least you can have it. So this is a simple F distribution statistical table from where you can see the tabulated values. Many of you are already familiar with this. What we have is, you see, it says degree of freedom for numerator. You can see with whatever you have, degree of freedom of the numerator and degree of freedom of the denominator. So from the table, you can have any combination. If you want to see the, for a factor, you want to see the tabulated value. So numerator is the degree of freedom of that factor, and denominator is the degree of freedom of error. I will tell you what error is. this is the degree. So suppose it is 2-2. Suppose it is 2-2. Again, you see when you cross 2 and 2, you again see two values. You are seeing all of you 19 and 99. 19 and 99. 19 is the value at 95% confidence level. And 99 is the value at 99% confidence level. So depending on the precision you desire out of your experiment, you can get this. Similarly, like I was mentioning, so in that case, I have 1, 2. 1 is the degree of freedom of the numerator. So 1 and 2. At 95% confidence interval, I get 18.51. If you see, I get 18.51. So this value I will use for calculating the confidence interval. That's all. So this is the meaning of F alpha. F alpha is there. VE is the error variance. As also this value, this will come from the ANOVA table. I'll just show you that ANOVA table. This is the ANOVA table. We'll come to it. I will explain in detail how I am constructing it. But you can see that I have error. If you see the fourth row, error. So error is degree of freedom 2. So degree of freedom of error is, how do I get 2? I have 9 experiments. So the degree of freedom of the orthogonal array is 8. 8 minus the degree of freedom of each factor. 2 minus 2 minus plus 2. So 8 minus 6, it comes out. It could be anything. Depending on the number of columns you have used, it could be anything. And this variance column, from here I get the error variance. In this case, the value is 0.0009. So these values I will use to calculate the confidence interval. Like I have calculated in this case using all these values, I used 18.51, I read from the table. Error variance 0.645, it comes from the ANOVA table. Then confidence interval I have obtained. This confidence interval I again change to raw data. This confidence interval is for SN ratio. By using the same formula which I used previously, yes, I get the confidence interval. So this, in fact, I have calculated for surface roughness. So that various error, that ANOVA table is not available here. But like in my case, if you notice here, last line, surface roughness was calculated to be 2.32 microns. The range which is now obtained is 2.08 to 2.57. Now, if as a result of my experiment, I get any value within this range, that means my experiment and my analysis has been accurately performed. Okay. So since the optimum combination of input process parameters did not exist in the orthogonal array, a set of 3 confirmation experiments were conducted. The average value of surface roughness obtained at this setting was 2.46 microns, which is within the confidence interval. So similar way, you can calculate the confidence interval for micro hardness also. Got it? Now we come to the last but very important part, that is the analysis of variance, which will tell me whether a factor was significant or not, and if it was significant, what was its relative importance. Okay. So you see here, this is the ANOVA table. First, I what do I do is first I calculate the sum of squares. Sum of squares. The formula for sum of squares is, you see here, sum of squares due to factor A. 3 times m a1 minus m whole square, m a2 minus m whole square. Here I am using the square value because m a2 minus m could be a negative value. Could be a negative value. Okay. So sum of squares due to factor A I have obtained. Very simple. Similarly, sum of squares due to factor B I have obtained. Sum of squares due to factor C I have obtained. Now the problem is to find out the sum of squares due to error. There I don't have any data available. How do I calculate it? By this formula. Total sum of squares is sum of the sum of squares due to various factors plus sum of squares due to error. Now sum of the sum of squares due to various factors that I have already obtained. If I get the left hand side, that is total sum of squares, I get the sum of squares for the error. So total sum of square is summation of all the 9 values of SN ratio minus M ka square of that. So with this, I will obtain the sum of squares. This column is clear. You can calculate for each factor and you can also calculate for error. Got it? Degree of freedom, I have already explained. All these three factors are 3 levels. So degree of freedom 2, 2, 2. Error 8 minus 2 is again 8 minus 6 is 2. 8 minus 6 is. What is variance? Variance is sum of squares divided by degree of freedom. Simple. Then F ratio. This is my most important parameter. F ratio for a factor. Variance of that factor divided by and percentage contribution of a factor, sum of squares due to that factor divided by total sum of squares. See how easy it is in 200. So I get all the data up to percentage contribution. So F ratio I have obtained. Now whether a factor is significant or not, if the calculated F ratio is more than the tabulated F ratio. This you can note down. If the calculated F ratio is more than the tabulated F ratio, the factor is significant. This tabulated was 19. If I am using 95% confidence level, so it is 19. Otherwise it would be 99. But you notice here in both the cases, this all these three factors will turn out to be significant. And you also get the percentage contribution. Peak current is most important. 70% contribution. Followed by pulse on time about 22% and pulse off time about 8% contribution. There is one very important significance of this percentage contribution. That is, since peak current is most important, I must use the best value of that factor, whatever was obtained from this experiment. So that means I must use 6 ampere current. 6 ampere current. Okay. pulse of time is not very significant. So even if I deviate a bit, that is not going to affect my experiment result significantly. That is the most important inference from this table. Okay. So ANOVA calculations I have also explained. Suppose I had 6 factors and 2 out of them come out to be insignificant. There are 2 ways you can proceed further. Either you can pool those 2 factors with your error, in which case this analysis will be known as a pooled ANOVA. You can pool your insignificant factor with your error. Another better method would be, if you really want good results, is to conduct your experiment again by eliminating those 2 factors. Got it? Suppose here there were only 3 factors. Suppose there are 6 factors. 2 of them come out to be insignificant. And you want to be really accurate. Aap research kar rahe hain, PhD ka kaam hai, bahut accurate hai. So what you can do is you can eliminate those 2. Now design a new experiment with only 4 factors. And conduct it again. You will get much better results. Otherwise, if you are not that much interested in accuracy, you can add that thing into error. The degree of freedom will also go into error. The sum of square will also go into error. So that way, error contribution will increase. But you will get other values will change slightly, but not much. Overall, the comparison will remain the same. Maybe peak current becomes slightly less significant, but it will still be the most significant factor. Got it? So we started with some details. Let us summarize. These were the main 4 objectives we were looking for. Optimum combination of process parameters. We are able to achieve optimum combination of process parameters. Best value of response parameter we were able to obtain, even if that combination was in the array or it was not there. We were able to obtain the best value of response parameter. Then by ANOVA, we were able to obtain the significance of process parameters and the relative contribution, relative importance of those process parameters. Got it? So now before I ask for questions, let me explain these techniques briefly. So this I've already explained, L18 orthogonal array. What is the dummy level technique? So dummy level technique allows us to assign a factor with m levels to a column that has n levels where n is greater than m. Okay, so we are explaining here on an L9 orthogonal array. So what I have done is, now suppose a factor has 2 levels A1 and A2. We can assign it to a 3 level column by creating a dummy level A3, which could be taken the same as A1 or A2. The choice between taking either we take A3 equal to A1 or we take A3 equal to A2 depends on many factors. Obviously, if a3 is taken as equal to a2, then the effect of a2 is estimated with 2 times more precision than the effect of a1, because now it is coming at 6 rows, so more double the precision. Thus, if a1 is the starting condition about which we have a fair amount of experience and a2 is the new alternative, we should choose a3 equal to a2. Availability of experimental resources and ease of experimentation also play a role here. If a1 and a2 are two different raw materials and a1 is scarce, then we may choose a3 equal to a2. The dummy level technique can be applied to more than one factors in an orthogonal array. So that way you can have so many factors, so many levels, they can be accommodated. So here is the example, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2. Then 7, 8, 9, again, I have used the level 1 only. Okay. So this way I can use my dummy level technique. Generalizing further, a 6-level factor may be assigned to a 9-level column by taking a7 equal to a1, a8 equal to a2, and a9 equal to a3. Or you could take a4, a5, with the logic being the same what we have already explained. Then we have the column merging method. The column merging method, this is slightly more difficult, slightly. The first one was very easy. The column merging method can be used to create a 4-level column in a standard orthogonal array with all 2-level columns. A 9-level column in a standard orthogonal array with all 3-level columns. Okay, so with the help of an example I have explained here, this is an L8 orthogonal array. What do I do? See, I have merged 1, 2, and 3 columns. 2 in any case I need to merge because I want more levels. Third is the column where the interaction between 1 and 2 is represented. Okay, so 1, 2, and 3 I have merged. So the degree of freedom of this merged column, 2 plus 2 plus 2, 6, minus 1, 5. So degree of freedom becomes 5. Okay. So 4 levels I am assigning. How I am doing it? Now for assigning, we will only concentrate on first the columns, first and 1 and 2, which we have merged. 1, 1, I have represented it as 1, 1. Second 1, 1, again 1. 1, 2 by 2. 1, 2 by 2. Then 2, 1 by 3. Okay. Third level. 2, 1 by 3, and 2, 2 by 4. 2, 2 by 4. So a factor of 4 levels has been accommodated in an array which can accommodate only 2-level factors. Got it? And again, you can compare the orthogonality of the array is not lost. So all possible combinations occur, and they occur equal number of times. In this case, only once they are occurring, like 1, 1 is occurring only once, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 4, 1. All these combinations are occurring. 2, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2. You see, all those combinations are occurring once only. Okay, similarly, you can do, suppose, Now suppose you have here, say again, why L18 is so useful. Now this one first column has 2 degrees of freedom. Second column has 3 degrees of freedom. So you can merge them. How you will do it? You see 1 1 1 1 1 1. You can assign as level 1. 1 2 1 2 1 2 level 2. 1 3 1 3 1 3 level 3. 2 1 2 1 level 4. Level 5. 2 2 2 2 and 2 3 level 6. So you are able to accommodate a factor with 6 levels in an array where only 2 and 3 levels are possible. So that is the technique of column merging method. And lastly, compound factor method. As I told you earlier, try to avoid it if possible, but if not possible, compound factor method allows us to study more factors with an orthogonal array than the number of columns in the array. For example, it can be used to assign 2 2-level factors to a 3-level column. So in one column, we are able to study 2 factors. How? Like, suppose we have 2 factors of 2 levels. What are the possible combinations? A1, B1, A2, B2, A1, B2, and A2, B2. Now, you see, compare this. A1, B1, and A1, B2. First and third. A1, B1, and A1. A1 is common. So, the level effect between these two will tell me the details of the effect when B is changing from 1 to 2. Now, if you take second and fourth, third and fourth, B2 is same. So, difference between these two will tell me the effect of changing A from 1 to 2 because B is common. So I have been able to study A1 to A2 also and B1 to B2 also using a 3-level orthogonal array. So this is the column merging method. This I have explained here. L9 I have used. So A1, B1 like that I have put. So this array has 4 columns, but I have been able to study how many factors? 5 factors with this. But if you will compare, the orthogonality is lost.